amen. Hallelujah. It's just so good to see y'all here on a Wednesday night. Seeing Brittany and Overcomers in Christ. Those of you, us who are blessed enough to be in the house yet another day. And those of you who are watching live on Facebook and YouTube, we just welcome you to our Wednesday night Bible study. Amen. Giving honor to our man and woman of God, Pastor John and Pastor Pat. They ask that we love y'all. We appreciate y'all. We thank y'all for being an example and example for all of us. And we just thank you, Pastor and Pastor, that we love you guys. And again, for without further ado, we want to do our confession of faith. Our confession is, people are standing in line to get into this church to hear the word of God. Every seat is filled in every service with expectations of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10:30 a.m., our Wednesday night service at 7 p.m., and any other service that we might have. All of our property is paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love him. We are 100% tithe bringers, and we live in the overflow of God's abundance. Every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and support. For this is a prosperous for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ, and the doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ, and the doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous gift for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ, and the doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what he has promised, he was able also to perform in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. So this time, we can get ready to our 91st Psalm. 91st Psalm. Okay. 91st Psalm says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his presence, and under his wings shall I trust. His feet shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the owl that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. A thousand shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes did thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall better break up your hands, lest thy death thy feet against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the jackal shall not trample under feet. Because he has shed his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him, and show him my salvation. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. But to everybody saying, I'm going to do a little different before I have y'all speak or have you guys sit nothing down. So again, welcome to tonight's Bible study. Our name is right after saying it to him. I know he's in his absence, and it's been an honor to talk to John and Pastor Pat and my lovely young lady right there. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm all queued up. Okay, ways to give. My apologies, ways to give. So, Again, we in this house, as we talk, you know, we talked about first lady, we are tithe bringers. And that being said, we do have the revelation of the tithe in this house. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, bless those tithe on today, Lord God. Give them the wisdom of understanding what it means to tithe, Lord Father, and have a giving spirit, Lord Father. Not be told to pay tithes, Lord Father, but to give, Lord Father. In the name of Jesus, Lord, continue to bless those who have to give, Lord Father, and those who don't have to give, but have the desire, Lord Father, to bless you, Lord God. Lord Father, we just thank you, we praise you, and we say, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So, to get into the word that God gave me tonight, the title of the message for tonight is, or the Bible study is, Resurrection of the Dead, and keeping what our pastor has been teaching us the last few weeks. The scripture for this evening is John 5:24-29. My thought is the resurrection of the dead is a principle fundamental to Christianity. And my question is, posed to you tonight is, when we are judged, will we be judged with the just or the unjust? And while you guys are, let's go to John 5:24-29.
Well,
all right, John 5:24 says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believeth on him that sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death into life." Verse 25, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now it is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they shall hear, ears shall live." Verse 26, "For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself." Verse 27, "And hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man." Verse 28, "Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice." And finally, verse 29, "And shall come forth they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of their nation." Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we ask that you bless the reading of your word on today, Lord God, that you bless us, Lord Father, as the word is shared on today, on tonight, Lord God, that it falls on good ground and courage to understand, Lord Father. We ask that you bless us, our man, woman, God, who are waiting on this evening, Lord Father, that we keep them lifted up on tonight, Lord Father. Lord God, we just thank you. We praise your name and say, in Jesus' name, amen.
And y'all have your faith speech in the presence of our life-changing King.
Before we get started, we're going to have a quiz. Dr. Say is rigged for me, but I'm not going to say that for me. Okay? So, you better get some research from them when we start this one. Okay. So, the first question is, so I know we've got folks that are watching on Facebook and the folks of us here in the building. So, the first question is, what was the main scripture of Sunday's message? What was the main scripture of Sunday's message? Ten. No, five. Four. Three. Two. One. Any thoughts here?
The main scripture.
Hey, man, call me. I know y'all got it. Where is God? Where did he go? 2 Timothy 1:5. See? I know. That's the ringers right there. Amen. Amen. All right, question number two. Proverbs 22:6 says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." What did Pastor Pat reveal it represented? Meaning, he would not be part of it. What did it represent?
four, three, two, one. Okay. Almost. Almost. How do I do that? This time you go, okie doke. She was that in one word. Amen. Come on, go ahead. Praying. That's it. That's it. Come on, nigga. You got that one? Okay. Okay. All right. Come on, snuck that in, guys. Those words, she's okie doke. Okay, this next one is a fill in the blank. A Christian life is a blank life. A Christian life is a blank life. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. Taylor. Amen, Colin. Thank you, y'all. Well, it is discipline. All right, the next one is true false. The fourth is true false. When we live like a Christian, means we are living as a Christian. True or false? When we live like a Christian, means we are living as a Christian. True or false? 3, 2, 1. The answer is false. False living like Christian is not the same as living as Christian. Just living a Christian life. Okay. Number 5. What are the 3 points of salvation? What are the 3 points of salvation? 4, 3, 2, 1. There you go. Okay. All right. Okay, number 6. This is a good one. Pastor Pat stated that Timothy, Eunice, and Lois all had their own faith and relationship with God. How did she break down the word relationship? Pastor Pat stated that Timothy, Eunice, and Lois all had their own faith and relationship with God. How does she break down the word relationship? 5, 4, 1, 3, 2, 1. Okay. That's what it is like that. Okay. Okay, my apologies. Okay, I need to get my act together. The answer is, relate to me on my ship. We must relate to God on his ship. Okay, amen. Okay, number 7. What are the 2 things Abraham did to attain his relationship with God, and what do they represent for us today? Yes. What were the 2 things Abraham did to attain his relationship with God, and what do they represent for us today? Who's in the message? Okay. Facebook, they got it already, don't they? Okay, I don't want to go to the go-to. Let's go to the go-to. Okay. God's will is represent working out there. Soul salvation, built all to represent working in God. See, y'all, that's all that right over that side over there. Okay. Amen. So the next couple are easy. This next one is true false. True salvation is received through prosperity. Again, true or false. True salvation is received through prosperity. 3, 2, 1. I think we'll follow this answer. Okay, almost done. Fill in the blank. Worry brings doubt, fear, and blank. Worry brings doubt, fear, and blank. That's easy. 3, 2, 1.
I know, sir.
Okay, last one. This is good. Whoever gets this one, it's up with the ball. Whoever gets this one is the one. Pastor Pat. Okay, the last one. Pastor Pat reminded us to honor Pastor John as the angel messenger of the house, which will cause us to prosper. What word is this?
No, why would you do it?
Just a bit. Okay, the answer is 2 Chronicles 20:20.
I told that whole side over there.
Amen. Thank y'all for that. Those were put together by the illustrious scholar that right there, y'all.
My wife.
You helped me out there with that one. I'm not that squared away. Good amen. So that's what he do. Anyway, amen. So I appreciate y'all participating in that. So resurrection of the dead. So, doing a study when Pastor asked me to stand there for him, I went, as I do often, harking back to not only what he's taught us, but what we both been taught through Bishop Holcomb. So our man of God that we love so dearly, and I've got that teaching from him, but I've heard it before, so just bear with me. So resurrection of the dead is actually the fifth rudimentary principle of the doctrine of Christ. So now, according to the teaching, there are six principles, and they can be found in Hebrews 6:1-2. So, okay, first one says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again in the foundation of repentance from dead works and the faith toward God, verse 2, of the doctrine of baptism and the laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead and the eternal judgment. So, the six principles of doctrine of Christ are what? The first one? Repentance from dead works. The second one? Faith toward God. It was right there in the scripture. I'm sorry. The third one is doctrine of baptism. You don't have to even put it back up there, guys. The fourth one is laying on of hands. The fifth one is the resurrection of the dead. And the sixth one is the eternal judgment. Amen. So the six, what the teaching shows us is those are the foundational stones of the doctrine of Christ. So now, based on the teaching from Pastor John, we'll focus on the resurrection and the true power associated with this foundational stone, that being the resurrection of the dead. Now, Pastor has given us a powerful word on the power of resurrection. So again, I want to focus on the definition of what that means. So I think Pastor John just shared with us that resurrection, the Greek word resurrection is anybody remember? I think it's anastasis. Anastasis, or for the scholar in the room, D386. Okay? It means a standing up or a rising up. With that, let's go to John. I think we've already read John 5:24-29 in the opening scripture. In this passage, Jesus talks about the resurrection in two ways, as a spiritual new birth and as a final judgment. What Jesus is trying to tell us here is those who heard and believed in him would experience the resurrection, and that they would pass over from one spiritual state to another. In other words, spiritual death into absolute life. So let's just look at specifically John 5:24, just that one verse. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. That there is powerful. Again, the revelation I've got to give. A lot of this teaching that I did it through friendship, and when you read it again, it's like these are fresh revelations. So that was powerful to me. The revelation is that prior to receiving Jesus Christ as our Savior, we are dead in sin, separated from the life of God. But the very second we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are made alive. Amen. So that's powerful for me. We're raised from the state of death and resurrected into life. So, Jesus referenced a coming hour in the 29th verse of what we just read, and which those in the grave would hear his voice and would come forth unto one of two resurrections, as I mentioned. The first resurrection was the resurrection of life, and the second one was the resurrection of damnation. This tells us that receiving or rejecting eternal life determines whether we pass from spiritual death to eternal life. So with that, let's look in greater detail at both of these resurrections. Let's go to John 11, 21 through 26. John 11, 21 through 26. We're going too fast, y'all. Please, slow me down. Okay, John 11, 21 says, then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. Verse 22. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God will give it thee. 23. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. That's verse 24. Martha said to him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Amen. Now, please understand, the resurrection of the dead is not some, when I was growing up, some wise tale or some fairy tale about, something that's not factual. It is actually a fixed principle, fundamental to Christianity, that this is part of who we are as believers. That's something that we know is the case. Again, to further prove that point, let's go to 1 Corinthians 15 to 17. 1 Corinthians 15 to 17. And if Christ did not raise, your faith is vain. You are yet in your sins. So, again, that was probably this scripture that Paul addressed the absolute importance of this doctrine that we're talking about tonight. Paul asserted that if Christ was not risen from the dead, then neither are we raised from spiritual death. And that our faith for God is vain. And we know that's a particular enemy. A lot from the pit of hell, so we're not going to believe that one. Moreover, we are dead in our sins with no hope of a future resurrection. The revelation that I got, during my study was that the belief in resurrection is not optional for us. There's no gray area. If you're a believer, resurrection is part of our doctrine that we practice as Christians. And it's not negotiable. The consequence of denying the resurrection of believers is that Christ was still in the grave. We know that's a lot of people here. Not only that, but all this teaching we've been getting from Pastor John and Pastor Pat, that all this is in vain without faith. And we know that's not because they were placed here to preach to us, to teach us, to lead us as our lead sheep. So again, we know what it is to hear the word of God and what that means to us in the time. Let's go to Romans 4 and 25. Romans 4 and 25. Romans 4 and 25. Did somebody get it? Yeah, Romans 4 and 25. Mm. Okay, the revelation here is since the resurrection of Christ is essential to our justification, then the denial of it undermines forgiveness of sins. That is the reason Jesus was compelled to elaborate on this, not only in Scripture saying that, but throughout the Bible, to explain the inherent power of the resurrection and its immediate ability to transition us from one realm to another, as we mentioned earlier. If we refer back to one of the scriptures that Pastor John shared with us a couple weeks ago, was about Jesus told Martha that Lazarus would rise again. Now, in the teaching, Martha said Martha is confused, by his statement with the final resurrection of the last day. However, according to the scripture, John 11:25-26. So, in response to Martha's comment in verse 21 specifically, Jesus made an unmistakable declaration. Jesus said in a statement of fact, "I am resurrection," or "I am anastasis," and life. And Jesus defined resurrection as not just an event in time, but that its origin is in Him. Hence, as our man of God has taught us already, 2 weeks ago, the resurrection is not something but someone. The resurrection is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And Jesus is indeed resurrected. He is the only one who can cause us to pass from a state of death into life. Separate or apart from Him, there is no resurrection. Again, if you're talking Jesus, there's no resurrection. Resurrection is a basic belief of what we understand as believers. So without that, there is no resurrection. No rising up. The rising of Lazarus is a lesson of this very principle. It emphatically depicts the new birth in which we actually come forth and from the realm of death, or we come in completely, and once we immediately translate to the story of life, or eternal life of God. Therefore, physical death for a believer is simply put a doorway to eternity if you believe in a resurrection. In this resurrection, the resurrection of death, there is no more dying. So, let's go to Revelation 1 and 8. Revelation 1 and 8. Or somebody can read to me. Revelation 1 and 8. Now, you can King James version if anybody has your hand. Amen. Simply put, Jesus holds the keys to hell and death. I mean, He has access, He has power over those things. Those things that we're fearful of, we're fearful of both of those. Jesus actually has the key to both of those. And if He's the Alpha and Omega, the first and last, the first of God's eternality and sovereignty, therefore the resurrection of the dead should not be seen as simply being raised from physical death. On the contrary, it means so much more. And the teaching shows us that the resurrection actually encompasses three areas. Again, we're talking about the resurrection of the resurrection itself actually encompasses three areas. The three areas are redemption. He purchased us with His blood. The second one is reconciliation. Reconciliation. He reconciled us to God. And lastly, restoration. He restored us to God's purpose. And again, I just hope that's in Revelation to me. As I read it for a second time, I really had to understand what this is the text and then what I explained it to you. Now, earlier text in John 5:24-29, verse 29 mentions two resurrections, the resurrection of life and the resurrection of damnation. And in Revelation 25:6, it's going to talk to how it's different resurrections. So if somebody could grab out Revelation 20:5 real quick. Okay. But the rest of the dead live not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first of resurrection. Verse 6, blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power, for they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. So the first resurrection is laid out in Revelation 25, and the second death, or second resurrection, is in Revelation 26. These two resurrections are considered tribunals or thrones of judgment, in which there is separation of what we are akin to weak from the dead. As a believer, I didn't really understand the tares versus the wheat until it was explained to me. I think Pastor John shared it with us a while back. But tares are actually weeds that look like wheat. So when you go through, you have to separate those two. It looks like wheat, but it's not good for it. It's not edible. But you have to separate that from the wheat, the actual wheat. So that was a revelation to me. He really did that teaching. I've never heard that before. Yeah, so now let's discuss the last bit. I've got a little bit to go, so bear with me. This study talks about all of mankind are judged under one of the following categories. And I guess part of my question was the just and the unjust. So, let me pull up Acts 24:15. It actually talks about the death penalty. So, they have hope toward God, which they themselves also allow, that there shall be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and unjust. For the resurrection of the just, this last because let's go to 2 Corinthians 5:10. 2 Corinthians 5:10. And it says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad." For the resurrection of the just, this scripture describes that after physical death, all mankind must stand before a tribunal and give account for their lives. This is a final judgment, and for the believer, this is the first resurrection in the tribunal, and it's actually called a bema. So, when I studied this out, bema is actually the Greek word for judgment seat. And for the scholar in the room, that is G-9-58. Okay? So, this term actually stems from the Greek Olympic games, the winners who appear before the bema or tribunal. The judges can get their award or a reward. Conversely, as believers, for us, we'd also appear the beam or the judges of Christ. As with the Greek athlete, as we as believers are rewarded for the race we've run in this life, whether it be good or bad. And I had a memory or experience not too long ago when I was playing paintball and, I was a winner. I was still on the battlefield, and the next thing you know, I was getting shot in the back. But it's okay. I was the one. I was expecting to see my reward, but I didn't. I'm not going to say what happened that day. But praise God, we had a good time, and God blessed us, and I still got to eat dinner that night. So I was blessed. There you go. So, also of note, though, the beam of judgment does not pertain to the punishment of our sins, transgressions, or iniquity. So we all know that was nailed to the cross of Christ. He paid for our sins, so that's not included when we go to judgment. So at the Bema, we all will give account for the things that we've done in this life and receive the reward we have earned. And don't get twisted. We don't get what we earn. As my wife had been a teacher, God, y'all see her, she's sitting there, and she's looking all sweet, and when she gives her children in school, let them not get in with it. That one right there, looking at each other. My wife said, you gonna do my work, that's what she said. They gonna do my work. But again, they getting what they're earning. This is akin to to what we as we do already in life, as we walk in Christ, and we as believers, and we know what you know what the word says, and we get preaching and taught every week, so we know what it means to run the race. But again, at the end of the day, you do what you earn. You know, nobody here spread their hands and look at the ball. So hey, you're gonna do what you deserve. So and that's for the believers. Now conversely for the unbelievers or the unjust, they have no part in that post-resurrection because they have rejected Jesus altogether. They're rejecting that as Jesus has the only means of salvation. They actually die without the Lord. Therefore, they are part of the second death that we just talked about some ago. We mentioned it in John 5 and 49, that Jesus turned the resurrection of the damnation. Having that revelation of what it means, again, Pastor just teaching us about the power of the revelation ever since Easter, and he took it out a couple of weeks. And then, as you know that, or learn that the belief in the resurrection, that is fundamental for believers. It's not something that may happen, or you get all these different theories. It is something basic to our foundational belief in our doctrine of Christ. So we just need to understand that and take that belief and know in our spirit that that is something that we hold on to as one of our foundational stones. And with that said, I am done. I am finished. Anybody have any questions, concerns, or anything that I said tonight that may have not made sense? Amen. Amen. Okay. Again, giving honor to our men and women of God who are not here. We love you all. We thank y'all. We thank God for you all daily. And we just so appreciative of y'all, how y'all love on us. And with that, and with all my heart and mind and prayer, yeah. Okay. I'll say it, please. And our benediction is the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his kindness upon thee and give thee peace. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Father, we just thank you on today, Lord God, for allowing us to come to your house on tonight, Lord God, and then get what we're saying tonight, Lord Father. We encourage you to stay, Lord Father. We are our man and woman of God, Pastor Pat and Pastor John, Lord Father, who are not with us tonight, Lord Father, but watching us, Lord God. We just thank you for them, Lord Father. And we keep them lifted up on today, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord Father. Bless those who are here, Lord God. Bless those watching on Facebook, Lord Father. We just thank you for the opportunity to come together as believers during this Wednesday night service, Lord Father.